right, you're still watching broadcast of the number one talk show, breakfast talk show on MITV, AM Chat. And of course, I'm still here with my colleague. We're just doing what we know how to do best. The next segment, you're here, and we're looking at the discussion this morning. And we said, we told you before we went for the break, that the militants are back. The return of the militants to the creeks. And of course, there's been a lot of blasting of very strategic pipelines on the sea level. And the recent one is a gas pipeline. Of course, this is going to cost close to 8.3 billion monthly to fix this. Okay, so today, we're looking at it, implications for the Nigerian economy, and of course this will possibly dovetail into the issue of the foreign investors running out of the country. Mr. Dimolo Olarewaju has just joined us. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
A public affairs analyst. Thank you, Mr. Dimolo Olarewaju. And of course, Dr. Patrick Amidi is still with us. Thank you, sir, for being with us. Just a background. These are the demands of the militants. One, agitators demand takeoff of the Maritime Varsity. This was a university being initiated by Jonathan. Okay, they're talking about cleanup of the environment, release of Nnamdi Kanu, funding of amnesty scheme. They also want a review of the oil blocks. Okay, trial of corrupt APC members, and of course demanding an apology from Buhari, DSS Silva over Alamasia. And Nigeria, we must know, the country loses 100 billion naira to Fukado's export pipeline disruption. And of course, attack on Chevron valve platform costs 8.3 billion naira. Wufa.
That was a very long analysis. It seems like we're almost done with the conversation.
Not really, but these are the demands. So
yes, I mean, you took time to analyze. It's a good thing that you gave us the background and insight into what these militants are demanding. But the issue of militants didn't just, you know, erupt today. We've had militants for yesteryear, militants of Abacha, but they came at first during Yar'Adua's time. First of all, they are giving us their demands. They're demanding for amnesty. They're demanding for the release of Nnamdi Kanu. I am very particular about the release of Nnamdi Kanu. They're demanding for a review of the national confab, what they had in 2014. From what Benjamin Peters has read, don't you think some of these demands are a bit self-centered?
Well, I mean, naturally, one would expect that the demands would be self-centered, you know, on those around the issues of the Niger Delta. I think the background to the whole militancy issue dates back to as far back as the discovery of oil in that area, and the consequent attempts by that area of the country to succeed, starting with Isaac Adakaboro, even before independence. Over the years, you know, the problem has been there. There has been that neglect. There has been that. The environmental degradation in that area. So successive governments have failed to tackle the problem, and this is why we are where we are now. I wasn't particularly a fan of amnesty, but I was a fan of keeping the peace. And if that was the price the Nigerian state had to pay, for the years of degradation, then so be it. But having inaugurated that, it was initiated by late President Umaru Musa Yar'Adua. After him, Goodluck Jonathan also continued that amnesty process. But people felt that because President Goodluck Jonathan was from the Niger Delta area, was from the South, that was why the amnesty was in place. But we feel we often forget that it was initiated by President Umaru Musa Yar'Adua, and it helped us to keep the peace. Now, in keeping that peace, it was a game of balancing. It was okay. You have militant problems. The state carries out the amnesty program to ensure that the militants secure the pipelines, and your oil production, your gas pipelines, everything was okay for a period. Now, I think in dealing with them, we have have to be able to look at the cost, the opportunity cost of it. Mm. If you decide to use force against them and they respond with force, what happens to our oil production? Mm. Because right now the problem is no longer even oil prices. Oil prices are rising, even above the benchmark that we had thought it was going to be initially. You know, it had fallen to below $30 per barrel. Right now it's approaching almost 50 naira, almost 40 to 50 naira. Per barrel. So our problem is no longer the oil pricing. Our problem is now the production of oil. And they understand this and they are playing on this. I think what President Muhammadu Buhari decides to do will go a long way to show the state is easy to be a statesman. As for the militants themselves, you know, well, it is a very unfortunate thing that there is this feeling that the Nigerian state does not respond except, you know, they resort to such things. I think those feelings have to be addressed. I think the present government has to reach out to the South, because for me, it plays into the politics of the situation. The president has to send a strong message to the South that you are a part of this nation and we cherish you. What I find curious is the Nnamdi Kanu connection, because one would wonder, and for me, that's just a way to ensure that they have sympathy from the Southeast, because Nnamdi Kanu really has nothing to do with the Niger Delta, but to find sympathy, you know, from the Southeast and ensure that there's that partnership, you know, so which is the political thing about it.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Demola. If you look at this issue critically, I think it tends to send us a serious signal that we must review this name Nigeria. Because there's been a lot of predictions, very fearful ones. And Doctor, what do you think should be the solution? Because with what is going on right now, it looks like Nigeria just exists on paper. It looks like we are sitting on a time bomb. They mentioned the National Confab.
This was a
voluminous document.
So
given,
much of money was spent.
Given to the president.
So much of time.
And we heard it's gathering dust in Aso Rock. What are your fears, if any, and what are your projections?
Well, I do not really see the problem as bigger than we can manage. If you look at the demand of the militant, you see a bit of sympathy for the then president, Goodluck Jonathan. The CONFAB issue that requires review is coming out of the fact that this is what this man did, and it's gathering dust, if I may use your word. So if Jonathan has dissipated so much energy and innovativeness, creativity, and fund to put the CONFAB together, what happened to the recommendation or the report? So there is a sympathy. And like our dear brother actually mentioned, talking about the issue of Nnamdi Kanu, for example, is to draw sympathy and kind of get support. Because if there's going to be an attack from the federal level on the militants, the eastern route is like to be a passage. So they want a situation where the eastern, you know, colleagues
and
can help those synergy to create a blockage in that area. But I think the way forward is this, sir. That we had crisis is not enough to call for cessation. What we can do within the bouquet that we have, Nigeria, we can come up with what I call ideology, philosophy that balance equation, everybody's happy, you are drawing, I'm drawing, and all that. Like the first speaker just mentioned, you can do things to ameliorate the body, to you know, to suit the emotion and to help physical development of the Niger Delta area. Once this is done, for example, you have, if you look at what happened, they blew up the pipe that carried fuel from Warri to, I think, Kaduna. And it's like telling the president, look, this thing come from us, and in your area you don't have an oil rig. So how come that you are drawing from our own resources? So we are going to disconnect you. Because why? We are the one that laid the eggs, and you just come here to pick. So there is a need. You cannot use force to solve the current situation. The fact that Yar'Adua came up with the concept of amnesty does not mean he was a weakling. And like he said, Jonathan decided to ride on that same wing. So the current administration, knowing the voter, how volatile the Niger Delta region is, and the importance of that region to the overall structure of the Nigerian economy, need to play softly. You give them the carrot, give them the necessary requirement, and we move on.
You know,
I do not think that Nigeria will break up. I do not see break up in sight. But I think what is happening is that we have not come to term to be able to accept ourselves and ensure that whoever qualifies for certain reward gets it. It cannot be distributed equally. There must, it definitely have to be skewed. That's what
Dr. Patrick, you talked about soft landing, and I've heard a few Nigerians talking about soft landing. The government has to take it easy on the militants, you know, let's give them, it's like the chicken and the egg. But let me ask you this question. It's a mindset thing. This thing has been going on for so many years. If you're talking about soft pedaling and soft landing, that's like a short-term plan. After a while, this government's administration comes and goes. The next government comes. We still have militants pulling up the pipelines. Looking at the president, Muhammadu Buhari, and his military background, we know he's always wanting to do things tit for tat. Because I listened to his conversation about Nnamdi Kanu, when he said Nnamdi Kanu was definitely going to pay for all the hard work he wrecked. And talking about Boko Haram as well, he said he's going to fight Boko Haram tit for tat. Now, if he wants to apply the tit for tat method with the, with the militants, would you now say he's wrong? In the sense that these are militants, they don't have anything doing, they don't have any paid employment, they don't have whatever it is profitable or being profitable to them. But if you look at the sections they come from, there's LNG Bonny Island. Do you hear of crisis and, you know, what's it called, controversies around Bonny Island energy? It's because the people who are in Bonny Island have been able to create a sort of livelihood for those people. We hear about lots of, you know, issues around other parts of Niger Delta, but I happen to hear things of such cropping up in Bonny Island. Don't you think creating a source of employment, you know, maybe a source of livelihood and changing the mindset and attitude of these people might go on a long-term plan rather than subpedaling and creating amnesty and others?
I think, you know, the idea behind the amnesty program was to take those militants and give them a source of livelihood. I know some of them have been trained in things like diving, some of them have been trained in things like welding, and so on and so forth. Interestingly, you know, the cabotage laws, you know, which came into, the recent cabotage laws came into place under former President Olusegun Obasanjo, provides that, you know, shipping companies, international companies, maritime, that they must have a certain percentage of Nigerian workers.
Okay.
But the thing is, you do not have Nigerian workers who are skilled in those areas.
Yeah.
And so these jobs still go to Filipinos.
Mm-hmm.
You know, those they work on the ships and so on.
Yeah.
So what the amnesty program was doing was taking our people out of Nigeria to places like South Africa, to places like Germany and so on,
yeah,
and train them in those jobs, then bring them back and get them absorbed.
Yeah.
You know, so it wasn't just about giving militants money, as people think. It was about taking them from the creeks, training them, you know, in different aspects of
work. Empowering them.
And an important part of it is also the maritime university.
Yes,
because when,
yeah,
you have a maritime university in the south there, you have more people who are going there because, you know, it's not just the ordinary courses. It's not just your medicine. It's not your law and so on. No, these are maritime universities, that go into all aspects of that maritime, some of which I've mentioned, you know, the welding, deep sea diving, you know, and so on and so forth, engineering, aspects of engineering, fixing the oil rigs and so on. So it was about giving them a sustenance. That was the idea behind amnesty. It wasn't just about handouts, as most people thought. You know, holistically, on the other hand, you have to look at it cuts to the heart of the federal structure of Nigeria. The fact that Nigeria is not yet a federation. The truth is this, you know, and we must remember this, that if we have an oil revenue based economy, and if your economy is oil revenue, if the bulk of your revenue is coming from oil, then it behooves you to take care of that part of the country. I mean, it is only natural that, you know, those feelings of angst will come up. For instance, you know, I know recently the Minister of Environment, Onyebuamina Mohammed, has been trying to engage in the cleanup of Ogoni land. You know, this cleanup should have happened about 4 or 5 years ago. I think the judgment was delivered about 4 or 5 years ago, but it's just happening now. And it is not only in Ogoni where you have the environmental degradation. In other parts of the Niger Delta, you have places where, you know, the oil spillage and so on and so forth. But it's always a back and forth, you know. Government will keep on insisting. The government sides with the IOCs, international oil companies, and says that, oh, it's the people of that area that damaged the pipeline, and that is why oil is spilled into their water. Whereas, you know, there's the natural effect also of gas flaring.
But the bulk of these hazards are from the people, are from the locals and the indigenous of this community.
No, I do not think so. I think the bulk of the hazards is from the IOCs themselves.
Look
at the effect of gas flaring,
yeah,
only gas flaring.
Yeah.
Nigeria is one of the last countries that is still engaging in gas flaring, open gas flaring like that. You know, other countries have signed up to the carbon emission. Nigeria is also a signatory to reduce your carbon footprint on the planet.
Yes.
That's to do with climate change. Global gas flaring reduction committee. Others have signed up to it, and others are working on it. Nigeria is one of those countries where our gas still escapes into the air, and this thing affects the climate in that in those particular areas.
Okay.
And then you have oil spills. You know, the Ogoni judgment is an example. You know, that was a direct judgment that indicted a particular oil company that, look, you guys are the ones responsible for this environmental degradation. So, you know, long term, the government has to put in place a plan to ensure that government, companies that are coming there to invest, leave the environment better.
Okay.
They have to adhere to international best practices, which is what should be happening.
May he still rest in perfect peace, talking about Tunji Brentwood,
yeah.
When he died. Atiku, actually, even Buhari himself, they talked about his struggle for a true federation.
Yeah.
He has been an advocate of that. But today is no more. And it became very interesting that these same leaders were also, they were commending him for thinking true federalism. Okay, but what I just wanted to raise up is their demand. Buhari must try APC corrupt politicians.
Yeah.
And of course, review oil blocks, because ownership of the oil blocks, Mr. Dimola, of course you're aware, is also owned by top retired military generals from the north. And how many oil wells do actually those in the major area where it was produced that owns the oil blocks? So I come back to the first question. I think we're sitting on a keg of gunpowder. The way we handle it is very key. But just to let the viewers know, you can call us. We'll have the phone number on the screen so you can participate. Go ahead.
You see, very simple. We don't need too many words.
Should Buhari try corrupt APC leaders?
The message being sent to Buhari is that he has focused his attention on PDP elect corrupt leaders only. And so they are saying your judgment must be holistic and must be devoid of bias. If the government is sensitive, this is a medium message sent in just one line. So the president must sit up and they must ensure that the books are open to include all and sundry. It shouldn't be a lopsided kind of, pursuit and looking, which hunting those who are in PDP only. It should be made universal. APC people are involved. And so there is a kind of covering. So what they are trying to say is that they are whipping up concern. You know, they are like, look, this man, your approach to corruption drive is biased, is lopsided. Make it general. It shouldn't be PDP only.
But that seems to be a genuine
case.
It's a
genuine case. And so you can't take that out of it. And like you rightly mentioned, the issue of maritime university is very, very germane and important to that region of the country.
Okay.
If that is the only thing they even get to empower their people, it's good enough. And it is the insensitivity of Buhari that led to this public declaration that university should be put on hold. I think it's a wrong decision in the right direction.
We heard that Tamichi was also actually was against the maritime university. But Mr. Dimola, the issue of reviewing ownership of oil blocks, you are a well-researched fellow. What do you think this will likely turn out to? Okay, good morning. We have a caller. Okay. All right, go ahead.
Please go on with your comments.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I think it's shared profiles.
Let me just say this.
Yes.
Why I agree with him, he must also understand one fact. In our opening remark, we said, if you look at the demand area, the university issue, the amnesty issue, the Nnamdi Kanu issue, there is a bit of, what I call a concern for Jonathan. They are feeling that the current administration is hitting the past regime too hard. And if you are going to destructure discredit all that the past regime has done, then we'll come hard on you. And so they are like seeking for this one word. If you must rule this country, you must rule it with concern and wisdom. You can call a madman without telling him you are mad. It is about the choice of word and strategy and approach. So it is the current administration that is using a wrong strategy to implement their goal. And these people are capitalizing on that.
Okay, Dimola.
It's like the Boko Haram members, Boko Haram officials coming out in the last administration to say, these are what we want, these are rules, terms and conditions. The federal government has to abide by them. Who are you to tell the government what you want, the terms and conditions, and the government doesn't live by your terms and conditions, you take to the streets and then you cause havoc.
Let me further add to that. Jonathan said, okay, Boko Haram, come forward. The people, represent Boko Haram, let's negotiate. Nobody showed up. Okay.
Even under Buhari, to Buhari had made an adventure to
them. Nobody showed up.
They have not shown up.
I'd like to get your thought process on that.
I think for me,
do you dictate to the government?
Well, ordinarily, no one should dictate to the government. I mean, it's a very outrageous idea that you have anybody dictating for government. But you see, it boils back to the political concept of legitimacy. Mm-hmm. That at a certain point in time, people in a country or the governed may start to resent your leadership, no matter how much votes you got or so and so on. It's about image, your image and your
managing
to them. It's about how you manage your image with them. And I think Dr. Anidi has been alluding to that look, what has been President Buhari's approach to the Niger Delta question? There's a feeling in the Niger Delta that some of these APC leaders are sort of imposed leaders. When you have leaders like Amechi, when you have leaders like former Governor Silva, and so on and so forth, as against those whom they feel are people who share their own political mindset and their own political tendencies. I think Mr. President could have done a lot. And you mentioned the Nnamdi Kanu issue. That, look, people forget the fact that Nnamdi Kanu was an issue under President Goodluck Jonathan. Nnamdi Kanu was always on radio calling Goodluck, former President Goodluck Jonathan, all sorts of names. But he wasn't that popular in the East. Why? Because President Goodluck Jonathan ensured that the East was firmly, in his government, that there was that synergy. You could see that, the East is working with President Goodluck Jonathan. Now, I think President Buhari needs to take more steps forward to ensure that the South is seen as working hand in hand with him. Yeah. Going after aides of former President Goodluck Jonathan, harassing and all those things, kind of sent a different message to those people. And then you also have the issue of the former DG of Nimasa, whom the court granted bail, immediately was granted bail, right outside the courtroom. He was rearrested by the EFCC. And while he was being rearrested, a video recording surfaced on the internet where the man was being harassed, pushed into the bus, on the floor, and so on and so forth. Now, whether you like it or not, Akolo Bokemi, he must have benefited one or two people, in the South. And when they see these things, they start to have that feeling. And then you have, the havoc that was wrecked, during the Rivers Rerun election. You have the Bayelsa election where havoc was wrecked. There is that feeling of being besieged. And when you allow people to have that feeling, some of them tend to resort, and this is not a justification for what is going on there. But I'm saying that the onus is on the president to reach out to them. I'm sure that, this thing can still be nipped in the bud.
Yeah.
It can still be nipped in the bud. There is still a political solution. He should work more with the governors of the South. I mean, so far he has visited only one South state, which is Cross River. I would want to see him visit more South state. I want to see him visit President Goodluck Jonathan. Nothing stops him from going to
President for Nigeria.
He's president for Nigeria,
Make that move. Let people see you. You know, I mean, during the election, before the election, we saw the president wearing South regalia. We saw him wearing Southwest regalia. We saw him wearing Southeast regalia, and so on and so forth. I mean, what stops you from making one or two national broadcasts wearing the national colors, or you know, wearing the national wearing clothing, ethnic clothing from all these places?
I mean,
those messages. I mean, when it got to a point, I remember at the point, Jonathan had to come to the Southwest to wear, you know,
you
traditional Southwest, you know,
that.
To ensure that you know you send that message out, you know, and show people that I am trying to carry everybody along, because this is not just a country of it's not a country of one monolithic people, you know, it's a country of different ethnic groups, and one has to balance those ethnic groups. So
I also think that the approach to rooting out Boko Haram or any other insurgency or whatever you call, no matter the nomenclature, elsewhere, it's not the same as in Niger Delta. The topography and the terrain in Niger Delta is unique, and so you cannot apply the same approach. In fact, I remember the then commandant of the JTF, as it General Lisia, made a statement. He said, I have been in this business of leading these people. We have come to the creek. He said, it is difficult. I'm quoting him. And he said, it required the efforts of all and sundry, all the stakeholders, including the community indigent, to, you know, overpower or to kind of create what I call stability in that region of the country. So if somebody is calling and saying they must come up, the Nigerian military should come up and rule them out, it's going to be a wild goose chase. And
okay,
so we have to be careful.
All right, Mr. Demola, let's look at the last caller, his comment, which from research, most of these militants, the leaders of these groups, they benefited so much, billions of dollars from Jonathan's administration.
Even here in Lagos.
Definitely. But
Lagos.
You know what? They were not helping their community. And that's what the last caller was saying, that some of the very key ones, Tumpulo and Co and all that, were doing this thing more for their own selfish whatever. How much money did they spend? How much scholarship were they able to initiate for their own people? Even when your son, you understand, was on seat and you had all it takes to seize the opportunity to make a difference. Of course, he said that Buhari should not succumb to blackmail. What do you think?
I think we cannot ignore the fact that indeed the amnesty program, at a certain point, you know, there were issues of people benefiting from the process, you know, at the expense of those under them. What President Buhari should have done, I think, would have been to look into the amnesty program and restructure it in such a way. Because, like I said, you know, because I took time to look at the amnesty program and I understood that many people were on scholarship. You know, many of those former militants, many of them were on scholarship at that time. You know, all across the world, all over the world. But then you also had people who were benefiting, who were feeding fat. Now, it was a two-pronged approach. Essentially, there was the approach to the ordinary militants, or did I say ordinary, or the lesser ones, you know, there was that approach of the foot soldiers, taking them out from the creeks and trying to ensure a sort of reform. But then there was also the problem of the warlords, or the overlords themselves, or the leaders of those camps.
Yes.
They also had to, their interests had to be taken care of, and that's what led to a situation of, you know, paying them to secure the pipeline, you know, and ensure that, okay, just don't cause trouble. I think President Buhari has to come up with a unique solution. I'm not totally against military force, but I'm saying that will military force achieve our aim? I do not think military force.
Okay, we have a caller. Good morning.
Hello, good morning.
Morning. What's the name and where are you calling from?
My name is Comrade.
Okay. Okay, go ahead, comrade.
Thank you very much for the discussion on board.
Okay.
I am also in Niger Delta.
Okay.
But I just want to remind all of you that the amalgamation of Nigeria being together does not really work well for everybody. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of people that are on tears. A lot of people are feeling pains. Nigerians are so quiet. Nigeria remains this fucking thing going on. If the Niger Delta militants come up today and decide to take any decision, because of the fact that the plain truth of it is that the amalgamation is back. From the time of Sir Abubakar, Safa Bajwa, to this time, we have General J.T. Agusti Rossi. We have another general, Yakubu. We have another general, Murtala Mohammed. We have another general, Richard Gore, but I don't want to repeat himself as a Democrat. And as we are talking right presently, a former general is still here. You don't have sense of administration. Nigerians are ashamed of themselves. They are only concerned about making Nigeria money live outside this country. I don't belong to any political party. Jonathan was here, and all what was happening was insecurity, insecurity, and insecurity. Democracy in Nigeria just started.
Obasanjo was just here to stabilize democracy. What's your point exactly?
Hello?
What's your point exactly? What exactly are you driving at?
Excuse me, I'm not hearing you too clear. I don't have too much time.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for your contribution. If we get him clear, what he's trying to say is that we have a problem in our hands.
That has been generational.
Well, no, we're talking about the issue of, we mentioned the past generals, because the military has actually ruled a larger part of Nigeria, and of course you see the retired generals coming back.
What he's saying, he's trying to say that we have leadership problem.
So is he saying it's generational?
It's not necessarily generational. He just mentioned that the people he mentioned are past leaders who also wear the cap of generals. You talk about Murtala, you talk about Obasanjo, and he said Obasanjo, of course, became a Democrat.
A reformed one.
General. He became a Democrat. And he's saying we now have another general, yet Nigerian problem is not yet solved. And he said that even when Jonathan came in, who happened to be a civilian, we have insecurity problem. And he's trying to allude that the amalgamation is not helping. Perhaps the feeling that the ethnic groups are too vast, and because we don't speak one language, we are having issue. I want to say there is no amount of, even if you say that Niger Delta alone should stand as a country, we are still going to have issue.
Definitely.
In Delta alone, for example, I know we have over 50 ethnic groups. I'm an Urobo man. You have the Joy, you have the Shekri, you have all of them over there. So there's still going to be ethnic problem.
Hello.
There's still going to be problem of tolerance and acceptance.
Dr. Bashukanidi, sorry to interrupt you, but very quickly, I wouldn't be fair to myself and to Nigerians if I don't touch this particular issue of the militants demanding an apology from the president to Allah Misia. I mean, what does this portend to us as Nigerians in the international community? Allah Misia is dead, for God's sake. And of course, we knew the havoc. I wouldn't say, let me not use the word havoc, but of course, we knew the controversies around Allah Misia. If they're asking, because I know they were very insistent that the president should apologize to Allah Misia. Apologize, I don't know, for the fact that Allah Misia was ruffled unjustly or unlawfully. I don't get it.
Well, for me,
where are the apologies, or where should the apologies be coming from, or what premise?
I can't remember who said this, but I know the quote. It says that one man's freedom fighter is another man's terrorist. You know, one man's freedom fighter is another man's terrorist. I think it all boils down to the to how people are seen in this country. Whether you like it or not, you know, some of us may see Allah Misia as a crook, as a criminal, and so on and so forth. But to some people, he was a hero. To some people, he was the lead fighter of resource control. I mean, the international community may see him as whatever, but you know, when you have a set of people who see him as a hero, that this was a man who stood up for resource control under General Olusegun Obasanjo, that's the perception in some places. And guess who also has that perception? The former president, Sani Abacha. There's still a Sani Abacha stadium right in Kano there. And I know, and I interact with a lot of people who will tell you that Sani Abacha was the most corrupt president that Nigeria has ever had. But right there in Kano, you have a monument of state, you know, to his memory. You understand? So it is a question of balancing. I mean, for them, you know, they see him as a hero, and they feel.
Should we be blinded by their own perception about Allah Misia? Should Nigeria be blinded by, you know, the perception of a section of people?
When we say Nigeria, we should not look at Nigeria as just the federal government. I think we should look at it as a country of different ethnic groups, and you know, breaking it down that way is very important. We should then ask ourselves, okay, in various parts of the country, how is Allah Misia seen? I'm sure, you know, various parts of the country would have different perceptions. So we look at the sum total of that opinion. And how do you know that? They've also mentioned the National Confab Report, you know, which is very important, because the National Confab Report is the most, for me, is the most serious document since pre-independence period that addresses the question of how do we want to live together, and do we even want to live together as Nigerians?
Thank you very much, Demola. Yeah, we just have two more minutes.
Let me just also add that the fact that they have what I call long list of demand doesn't really mean that all of them are prioritized equally. In making a demand of this nature, they will factor in several things to make up the list.
Okay, gentlemen.
But we should be sensitive to the most important, the comfort and the management issue.
Okay, just a final word from you, Demola. Thanks for coming, Demola. Looking at this issue, just a final word, what's the solution?
I think Mr. President, President Muhammadu Buhari needs to read that National Confab report, read it from cover to cover. I think you should read it from cover to cover, look into it if there's any merit in it, because I am certain that there's a lot of merit in it. It takes care of every, I mean, these are, it's the best document that addresses the issue of Nigeria's federalism going forward. I think you should look into that document.
Okay, doctor.
Yeah, I agree with that. And I also think that in implementing amnesty projects, there should be a way of managing the allocation rather than, you know, appointing just one person and giving that person all the balls. I think a person can be appointed, but the distribution of whatever goes around should be from.
Okay, I won't be asking Wolf, I was a final word.
What's my final word?
Okay, yeah.
Benjamin Peters, you're putting me on the spot. Okay, my final word to the militants, I think.
Not to the militants on the broadcast so far.
My final word on the broadcast, I think it's been wholesome. I wish we had some more time to dwell on some of these issues a lot more.
Yeah.
But it's been wholesome. I mean, it's been a very productive one. I hope you benefited, you know, one thing or the other. Feel free to go on our Twitter handle at MITB Lagos. Make your views and comments count, yes, at all times. It's been very, very productive here. My name is Wolf Isamela. See you all again, same time, next week. Goodbye.
Okay, thank you very much, gentlemen, for coming. Well, we've just heard it all. Before the guests have talked about the president applying caution and wisdom so that the militants do not keep raging on. From all of us here, thanks for watching. Good morning.